those lips are red, not so sweetly wound for snow, and those eyes the break of day, lights that dove his feet upon, but my kisses sealed in vain, but my kisses bring again seals of love, but sealed in vain.
Her father loved me, oft invited me, still questioned me the story of my life from year to year, the battles, sieges, fortunes that I have passed. I ran it through even from my boyish days to the very moment that he bade me tell it, wherein I spake of most disastrous chances, of moving accidents by flood and field, of hairbreadth scapes in the imminent deadly breach, of being taken by the insolent foe and sold to slavery, of my redemption thence, and portents in my travels' history, wherein of entries vast and deserts idle, rough quarries, rocks, and hills whose heads touch heaven, it was my hint to speak, such was the process, and of the cannibals that each other eat, the anthropophagi, and men whose heads do grow beneath their shoulders. This to hear, would Desdemona seriously incline? But still the house affairs would draw her thence, whichever as she could with haste dispatch, she'd come again, and with a greedy ear devour up my discourse, which I observing took once a pliant hour, and found good means to draw from her a prayer of earnest heart, that I would all my pilgrimage dilate, whereof by parcels she had something heard, but not intentively. I did consent, and often did beguile her of her tears when I did speak of some distressful stroke that my youth suffered. My story being done, she gave me for my pains a world of sighs. She swore in faith, 'twas strange. 'Twas passing strange, 'twas pitiful, 'twas wondrous pitiful. She wished she had not heard it, yet she wished heaven had made her such a man. She thanked me and bade me, if I had a friend that loved her, I should but teach him how to tell my story, and that would woo her. Upon this hint I spake. She loved me for the dangers I had passed, and I loved her that she did pity them. This only is the witchcraft I have used.
Good faith, how foolish are our minds. If I do die before thee, I prithee, shroud me in one of those same sheets.
Come, come, you talk.
My mother had a maid called Barbara. She was in love, and he she loved proved mad and did forsake her. She had a song of Willow. An old thing it was, but it expressed her fortune, and she died singing it. That song tonight will not go from my mind. I have much ado but to go hang my head all at one side and sing it like poor Barbara. Prithee, dispatch.
Shall I go fetch your nightgown?
No, unpin me here. This Lodovico is a proper man.
A very handsome man.
And he speaks well.
I know a lady in Venice would have walked barefoot to Palestine for a touch of his nether lip.
The poor soul sat sighing by a sycamore tree. Sing willow, 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 her hand on her bosom her head on her knee. Sing, willow, 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 willow. Sing, willow, 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 willow. Must be my garland. Lay by these. Sing, willow, 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 willow. Prithee, hie thee. He'll come anon. Let nobody blame him. His scorn I approve. No, that's not next. Hark! Who is it that knocks?
It's the wind.
I called my love false love, and what said he then? Sing, willow, willow, willow. If I court more women, you'll couch with more men. So, get thee gone. Good night. Mine eyes do itch. Doth that bode weeping?
'Tis neither here nor there.
I have heard it said so. Oh, these men, these men. Dost thou in conscience think? Tell me, Amelia, that there be women to abuse their husbands in such gross kind.
There be some such, no question.
Wouldst thou do such a deed for all the world?
Why, would not you?
No, by this heavenly light.
Nor I neither by this heavenly light. I might do it as well in the dark.
Wouldst thou do such a deed for all the world?
The world's a huge thing. It is a great price for a small vice.
Good troth, I think thou wouldst not.
Hey, troth, I think I should. And undo it when I'd done. Marry, I would not do such a thing for a joint ring, nor for measures and lawn, nor for gowns, petticoats, nor caps, nor any petty exhibition, but for the whole world. That's pity who would not make a husband a cuckold to make him a monarch. I'd venture purgatory for it.
Good night, good night. Heaven me such usage send, not to pick bad from bad, but by bad mend.
Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
He wakes. Speak to him.
Madam, do you? 'Tis fittest.
How does my royal lord? How fares your majesty?
You do me wrong to take me out of the grave. Thou art a soul in bliss, but I am bound upon a wheel of fire that mine own tears do scald like molten lead.
Sir, do you know me?
You are a spirit, I know. When did you die?
Still, still, far wide.
Where have I been? Where am I? Fair daylight, I am mightily abused. I should e'en die with pity to see another thus. I know not what to say. I will not swear these are my hands. Let's see, I feel this pin prick. Would I were assured of my condition.
Oh, look upon me, sir, and hold your hands in benediction o'er me. No, sir, you must not kneel.
Pray do not mock me. I am a very foolish, fond old man. 40 and upward, not an hour more nor less. And to deal plainly, I fear I am not in my perfect mind. Methinks I should know you, and know this man. But I am doubtful, for I am mainly ignorant what place this is. And all the skill I have remembers not these garments. Nor do I know where I did lodge last night. Do not laugh at me, for as I am a man, I think this lady to be my child, Cordelia.
And so I am. I am
be your tears wet. Yes, Faith, I pray weep not. If you have poison for me, I will drink it. I know you do not love me, for your sisters have, as I do remember, done me wrong. You have some cause. They have not.
No cause. No cause.
Am I in France?
In your own kingdom, sir.
Do not abuse me.
Will please your highness walk?
You must bear with me. Pray you now, forget and forgive. I am old and foolish.
Give me my robe. Put on my crown. I have immortal longings in me. Now no more the juice of Egypt's grape shall moist this lip. Yeah, good Iris, quick. Methinks I hear Antony call. I see him rouse himself to praise my noble act. I hear him mock the luck of Caesar, which the gods give men to excuse their after-off. Husband, I come. Now to that name my courage prove my title. I'm fire and air. My other elements I give to baser life. So, have you done? Come then and take the last warmth of my lips. Farewell, kind Charmian. Iris, long farewell. Have I the aspic in my lips? Dost fall? If thou and nature can so gently part, the stroke of death is as a lover's pinch, which hurts and is desired. Dost thou lie still? If thus thou vanishest, thou tell'st the world it is not worth leave-taking. Come, thou mortal wretch, with thy sharp teeth, this knot intrinsicate of life, at once untie. Poor venomous fool, be angry and dispatch. Oh, couldst thou speak, that I might hear thee call great Caesar ass unpolicied. Shh. Peace. Dost thou not see my baby at my breast that sucks the nurse asleep? As sweet as balm, as soft as air, as gentle. Oh, Antony, nay, I will take thee too. What should I stay?
Hark, 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 the lark at heaven's gate sings. Heaven's gate sings, and feeble skins to rise, his steeds to water at those springs, at those springs. On chaliced flowers that lies, the winking merry buds begin to ope their golden eyes with everything that brings. My lady sweet, arise, 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 my lady sweet, arise.
Fear no more the heat of the sun, nor the furious winter's rages. Thou thy worldly task hast done, home art gone and ta'en thy wages. Golden lads and girls all must, as chimney sweepers, come to dust.
Fear no more the frown of the great. Thou art past the tyrant's stroke. Care no more to clothe and eat. To thee the reed is as the oak. The sceptre, learning, physic, must all follow this and come to dust.
Fear no more the lightning flash,
nor the all dreaded thunderstone.
Fear not slander, censure rash.
Thou hast finished joy and moan.
All lovers young, all lovers must consign to thee and come to dust. No exorciser harm thee,
nor no witchcraft charm thee.
Ghost unlaid forbear thee,
nothing ill come near thee.
Quiet consummation have,
and renowned be thy grave.
Now, my fairest friend, I would I had some flowers of the spring that might become your time of day, and yours, that wear upon your virgin branches yet your maidenhead's growing. O Proserpina, for the flowers now that frighted thou letst fall from Dis's wagon, daffodils that come before the swallow dares, and take the winds of March with beauty, violets dim, but sweeter than the lids of Juno's eyes or Cytherea's breath. Pale primroses that die unmarried, ere they can behold bright Phoebus in his strength, a malady most incident to maids. Bold oxlips and the crown imperial, lilies of all kinds, the flower de luce being one. Oh, these I lack to make you garlands of, and my sweet friend, to strew him o'er and o'er.
What, like a course?
No, like a bank for love to lie and play on, not like a course. Or if, not to be buried, but quickened in mine arms. Come, take your flowers. Methinks I play as I have seen them do in wits and pastorals. Sure, this robe of mine does change my disposition.
What you do still betters what is done. When you speak, sweet, I'd have you do it ever. When you sing, I'd have you buy and sell so. So give alms, pray so. And for the ordering your affairs, to sing them too. When you do dance, I wish you a wave of the sea that you might ever do nothing but that. Move still, still so, and own no other function. Each your doing, so singular in each particular, crowns what you are doing in the present deeds, that all your acts are queens.
Sir, I desire you do me right and justice, and bestow your pity on me, for I am a most poor woman and a stranger, born out of your dominions, having here no judge indifferent, nor no more assurance of equal friendship and proceeding. Alas, sir, in what have I offended you? What cause hath my behaviour given to your displeasure, that thus you should proceed to put me off and take your good grace from me? Heaven witness I've been to you a true and humble wife, at all times to your will conformable, ever in fear to kindle your dislike, yea, subject to your countenance, glad or sorry, as I saw it inclined. When was the hour I ever contradicted your desire, or made it not mine too? Or which of your friends have I not strove to love, although I knew he were mine enemy? What friend of mine that had to him derived your anger, did I continue in my liking? Nay, gave notice he was from thence discharged. Sir, call to mind that I have been your wife in this obedience upward of 20 years, and have been blessed with many children by you. If in the course and process of this time you can report and prove it too against mine honour aught, my bond to wedlock or my love and duty against your sacred person, in God's name, turn me away, and let the foulest contempt shut door upon me, and so give me up to the sharpest kind of justice.
Farewell, a long farewell to all my greatness. This is the state of man. Today he puts forth the tender leaves of hopes, tomorrow blossoms and bears his blushing honors thick upon him. The third day comes a frost, a killing frost. And when he thinks, good easy man, full surely his greatness is a ripening, nips his root, and then he falls as I do. I have ventured like little wanton boys that swim on bladders this many summers in a sea of glory, but far beyond my depth, my high-blown pride at length broke under me, and now has left me, weary and old with service, to the mercy of a rude stream that must forever hide me. Vain pomp and glory of this world, I hate ye. I feel my heart new opened. Oh, how wretched is that poor man that hangs on prince's favors. There is betwixt that smile we would aspire to, that sweet aspect of princes, and their ruin, more pangs and fears than wars or women have. And when he falls like Lucifer, never to hope again.
Sitting on a bank, weeping again the king my father's wreck, this music crept by me upon the waters, allaying both their fury and my passion with its sweet air. Thence I have followed it, or it hath drawn me, rather. But 'tis gone. No, it begins again. Ditty does remember my drowned father. This is no mortal business, nor no sound that the earth owes. I hear it now above me.
The fringed curtains of thine eye advance, and say what thou seest yond.
What is? A spirit? Lord, how it looks about. Believe me, sir, it carries a brave form, but 'tis a spirit.
No, wench. It eats and sleeps, and hath such senses as we have, such. This gallant which thou seest was in the wreck, and but he's something stained with grief that's beauty's canker, thou mightst call him a goodly person. He hath lost his fellows and strays about to find them.
I might call him a thing divine, for nothing natural I ever saw so noble.
It goes on, I see, as my soul prompts it. Spirit, fine spirit, I'll free thee within 2 days for this.
Most sure the goddess on whom these heirs attend. Vouchsafe my prayer, may know if you remain upon this island, and that you will some good instruction give how I may bear me here. My prime request, which I do last pronounce, is, oh, you wonder if you be maid or no.
No wonder, sir. But certainly a maid.
My language, heavens!
At the first sight they have changed eyes. Delicate Ariel, I'll set thee free for this. You do look, my son, in a moved sort, as if you were dismayed. Be cheerful, sir. Our revels now are ended. These are actors, as I foretold you, are all spirits and are melted into air, into thin air. And like the baseless fabric of this vision, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples, the great globe itself, yea, all which it inherits, shall dissolve. And like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a rack behind. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life is rounded with a sleep. Ye El Books, standing lakes and groves, and ye that on the sands with printless foot do chase the ebbing Neptune and do fly him when he comes back, you demi puppets that by moonshine do the green sour ringlets make whereof the ewe not bites, and you whose pastime is to make midnight mushrooms that rejoice to hear the solemn curfew, by whose aid, weak masters though ye be, I have bedimmed the noontide sun, called forth the mutinous winds, and twixt the green sea and the azured vault set roaring war. To the dread rattling thunder have I given fire, and rifted Jove's stout oak with his own bolt. The strong-based promontory have I made shake, and by the spurs plucked up the pine and cedar. Graves at my command have waked their sleepers, oped and let them forth. By my so potent art. But this rough magic I here abjure, and when I have required some heavenly music, which even now I do, to work mine end upon their senses that this airy charm is for, I'll break my staff, bury it certain fathoms in the earth, deeper than did ever plummet sound, I'll drown my book.
Good friend, for Jesus' sake, forbear to dig the dust, enclose it here. Blessed be the man that spares these stones, and cursed be he that moves my bones.
To the most noble and incomparable pair of brethren, William, Earl of Pembroke, Lord Chamberlain to the King's most excellent Majesty, and Philip, Earl of Montgomery, gentleman of His Majesty's bedchamber, both knights of the most noble order of the Garter, and our singular good lords. Right Honourable, whilst we study to be thankful in our particular for the many favours we have received from your lordships, we are fallen upon the ill fortune to mingle two of the most diverse things that can be, fear and rashness. Rashness in the enterprise and fear of the success. For when we value the places your highnesses sustain, we cannot but know their dignity greater than to descend to the reading of these trifles. And while we name them trifles, we have deprived ourselves of the defence of our dedication. But since your lordships have been pleased to think these trifles something heretofore, and have prosecuted both them and their author, living, with so much favour, we hope that they outliving him, and he not having the fate common with some, to be executor to his own writings, you will use the like indulgence toward them you have done unto their parent. There is a great difference whether any book chooses patrons or find them. This hath done both. For so much were your lordship's likings of the several parts, when they were acted, as before they were published, the volume asked to be yours. We have but collected them, and done an office to the dead, to procure his orphans guardians, without ambition either of self-profit or fame, only to keep the memory of so worthy a friend and fellow alive as was our Shakespeare, by humble offer of his plays to your most noble patronage. Wherein, as we have justly observed, no man to come near your lordships but with a kind of religious address, it hath been the height of our care, who are the presenters, to make the present worthy of your highnesses by the perfection. But there we must also crave our abilities to be considered, my lords. We cannot go beyond our own powers. Country hands reach forth milk, cream, fruits, or what they have. And many nations we have heard, that hath not gums and incense, obtain their requests with a leavened cake. It was no fault to approach their gods by what means they could, and the most, though meanest, of things are made more precious when they are dedicated to temples. In that name, therefore, we most humbly consecrate to your highnesses these remains of your servant Shakespeare, that what delight is in them may be ever your lordship's, the reputation his and the faults ours, if any be committed by a pair so careful to show their gratitude both to the living and the dead, as is your lordship's, most bounden, John Heming, Henry Condell.
God give you good morrow, my masters. Past 3 o'clock and a fair morning.
New muscles, new lily white muscles.
Heart, codling's heart. New cockles, new great cockles.
New great sprats.
New great red
sprats.
Fine pomegranates,
hard mutton pies, hard.
Have you any old bells or trace?
Rosemary and beans,
quick and juice. Ripe chestnuts,
ripe walnuts,
ripe small nuts, ripe.
White cabbage, white young cabbage,
white turnips, white young turnips,
white parsnips, white young parsnips,
white lettuce, white young lettuce, white.
Will you buy any pens? Very fine writing ink. Will you buy any ink?
Have you any rats or mice?
I have rye, peas, and dry.
Oysters, oysters, oysters. Fragments of peck-head bride will stairs. New wall-fleet oysters.
Oh, yes. If any man or woman can tell any tidings of a grave. Short tail, she haunts
will
my
you buy any fine turban?
And is stark lame behind, and was lost the 30th day of February. He that can tell any tidings of her, let him come to the crier, and he shall have well for his heart.
Ripe damsons, fine ripe damsons,
hard garlic, hard.
Buy
a barrel of samphire.
What does your lack? Fine wrought shirts or smocks?
Perfume, waistcoats, fine boneless or edgings, sweet gloves, silk gartons, very fine silk gartons, fine combs and glasses.
For a poking stick with a silver handle.
Doublets, old doublets, old doublets, old doublets, old doublets. Have you any old doublets? Fine potatoes, fine.
Will you buy any starch or clear complexion, mistress?
Oh, naked bedroom, Tom's a cold, a small cut of thy bacon, or a piece of thy sound sideboard beds. God Almighty, bless thy will.
Pity the poor women, will I call and call.
to the great variety of readers, from the most able to him that can but spell. There you are numbered. We had rather you were weighed, especially when the fate of all books depends upon your capacities, and not of your heads alone, but of your purses. Well, it is now public, and you will stand for your privileges, we know, to read and censure. Do so, but buy it first. That doth best commend a book, the stationer says. Then, how odd soever your brains be, or your wisdoms, make your license the same, and spare not. Judge your sixpenneth, your shilling's worth, your 5 shillings' worth at a time, or higher, so you rise to the just rates, and welcome. But whatever you do, buy. Censure will not drive a trade, or make the jack go. And though you be a magistrate of wit, and sit on the stage at Blackfriars or the cockpit to arraign plays daily, no, these plays have had their trial already, and stood out all appeals, and do now come forth quitted rather by a decree of court than any purchased letters of commendation. It had been a thing, we confess, worthy to have been wished, that the author himself had lived to have set forth and overseen his own writings. But since it hath been ordained otherwise, and he by death departed from that right, we pray you do not envy his friends the office of their care and pain to have collected and published them, and so to have published them, as where before you were abused with divers stolen and surreptitious copies, maimed and deformed by the frauds and stealths of injurious impostors that exposed them, even those are now offered to your view cured and perfect of their limbs, and all the rest absolute in their numbers as he conceived them, who, as he was a happy imitator of nature, was a most gentle expresser of it. His mind and hand went together, and what he thought he uttered with that easiness that we have scarce received from him a blot in his papers. But it is not our province, who only gather his works and give them you, to praise him. It is yours that read him. And there we hope, to your divers capacities, you will find enough both to draw and hold you, for his wit can no more lie hid than it could be lost. Read him, therefore, and again, and if then you do not like him, surely you are in some manifest danger not to understand him. And so we leave you to other of his friends, whom, if you need, can be your guides. If you need them not, you can lead yourselves and others, and such readers we wish him. John Heming, Henry Condell.
Ben Jonson, writing of Shakespeare, in his book Timber, or Discoveries Made Upon Men and Matter. I remember the players have often mentioned it as an honour to Shakespeare that in his writing, whatsoever he penned, he never blotted out line. My answer hath been, would he had blotted 1,000, which they thought a malevolent speech. I had not told posterity this, but for their ignorance who choose that circumstance to commend their friend by, wherein he most faulted, and to justify mine own candor, for I loved the man, and to honor his memory, on this side idolatry, as much as any. He was indeed honest, and of an open and free nature, had an excellent fancy, brave notions, and gentle expressions, wherein he flowed with that facility that sometimes it was necessary he should be stopped. His wit was in his own power. Would the rule of it had been so too. But he redeemed his vices with his virtues. There was ever more in him to be praised than to be pardoned.
Will you go with a pair of
Will you go with me, sir? I am Sir John Chimney's man.
Good, sir.
I am the first man, sir.
Good. And it be roasted. How long about the cabin?
Hot coming's hot. New place, new oysters,
yes. Young went to follow the years, and to the Cryonese, who never bore his hire.
Have you any kitchen stuff, maid?
Have you any work
for a then have you of gold or silver?
Oh, it's strawberries ripe, hot spice cakes
hot. What glorious gifts have you?
Any
strong
new fresh herring at Billings
white radish, white young radish, white young cabbage, white
pudding,
have you
bread and meat for the prisoners of the Marshalsea for Christ Jesus' sake, bread and meat.
Sweep, chimney sweep, Mr. Swither, hey, derry, 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 sweep. From the bottom to the top, sweep, chimney sweep. There shall the soot fall into your porridge pot with a hey, derry, 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 sweep.
Fine Seville oranges, fine lemon.
12 o'clock, look well to your lock, your fire and your light.
And so
to the memory of my beloved, the author, Master William Shakespeare, and what he hath left us. Soul of the age, the applause, delight, the wonder of our stage, my Shakespeare, rise. I will not lodge thee by Chaucer or Spenser, or bid Beaumont lie a little further to make thee a room. Thou art a monument without a tomb, and art alive still, while thy book doth live, and we have wits to read and praise to give. That I not mix thee so, my brain excuses, I mean with great, but disproportion muses. For if I thought my judgment were of years, I should commit thee surely with thy peers, and tell how far thou didst our Lily outshine, or Sporting Kid, or Marlowe's mighty line. And though thou hadst small Latin and less Greek, from thence to honour thee I would not seek for names, but call forth thundering Aeschylus, Euripides, and Sophocles to us, Pacuvius, Accius, him of Cordova dead, to life again, to hear thy buskin tread and shake a stage. Oh, when thy socks were on, leave thee alone for the comparison of all that insolent Greece or haughty Rome sent forth, or since did from their ashes come. Triumph, my Britain! Thou hast one to show to whom all scenes of Europe homage owe. He was not of an age, but for all time, and all the muses still were in their prime when, like Apollo, he came forth to warm our ears, or like a Mercury to charm. Nature herself was proud of his designs, and joyed to wear the dressing of his lines, which were so richly spun and woven so fit, as since she will vouchsafe no other wit. The merry Greek, tart Aristophanes, neat Terence, witty Plautus, now not pleased, but antiquated and deserted lie, as they were not of nature's family. Yet must I not give nature all. Thy art, my gentle Shakespeare, must enjoy a part. For though the poet's matter nature be, his art doth give the fashion. And that he who casts to write a living line must sweat such as thine are, and strike the second heat upon the muse's anvil, turn the same, and himself with it, that he thinks to frame, or for the laurel he may gain a scorn. For a good poet's made as well as born, and such wert thou. Look how the father's face lives in his issue. Even so the race of Shakespeare's mind and manners brightly shines in his well-turned and true-filed lines. in each of which he seems to shake a lance as brandished at the eyes of ignorance. Sweet swan of Avon, what a sight it were to see thee in our waters yet appear, and make those flights upon the banks of Thames that so did take Eliza and our James. But stay, I see thee in the hemisphere advanced, and made a constellation there. Shine forth, thou star of poets, and with rage or influence chide or cheer the drooping stage, which since thy flight from hence hath mourned like night and despair's day, but for thy volume's light.
What needs my Shakespeare for his honoured bones, the labour of an age in pallid stones, or that his hallowed relics should be hid under a star-appointing pyramid? Dear son of memory, great heir of fame, what needst thou such weak witness of thy name? Thou, in our wonder and astonishment, hast built thyself a livelong monument. For whilst to the shame of slow endeavouring art thy easy numbers flow, and that each heart hath from the leaves of thy unvalued book those Delphic lines with deep impression took, then thou, our fancy of itself bereaving, dost make us marble with too much conceiving, and so sepulchred in such pomp dost lie, that kings for such a tomb would wish to die.